Good morning, good afternoon, good evening, everybody. I can see that some of you are from Spain, from Italy, from Malta, from Singapore. I saw someone from Uruguay, Ecuador. Hello. Very good welcome to you today. And thank you very much for joining us in this webinar. From good evening from Malaysia, Morocco. Fantastic. So great to see people from all over the world, Brazil, Russia, Argentina, Chile, Indonesia, Vietnam, Romania. Fantastic. Pakistan, I just saw, Georgia, Mexico. Wow. Some of you have got a very early start to the day. Okay. Well, thank you very much for taking your time to join us today to this COVID-19 guidelines for Invigilator training webinar, which is also relevant for supervisors, of course, centre exam staff, and also speaking examiners. Hi from Egypt, Qatar, Borneo, amazing. Nigeria, hello. Okay. So this webinar will focus on the COVID-19 guidelines you need to be aware of whilst invigilating or supervising candidates on the exam day. You may have received recently Invigilator training from your exam centre or your Cambridge Assessment English Regional Office. The regulations more or less the same on how to invigilate our exams, but with additional measures to take into account. This webinar is to show you what exam centres have already been doing and how they've adapted to the situation we are all experiencing at this present time. It's also an opportunity for you to visualise what it will look like for you and what your role and tasks will be on the exam day, especially for those of you who have not done any invigilating or supervising since before the current crisis. My name is Yasmin Hanspool. I'm a Centre Development Manager in the Centre Management Team, which is part of Customer Support in Cambridge Assessment English. I am delivering this webinar today from my home in Cambridge, United Kingdom. And one of my main responsibilities is providing face-to-face and online training for exam centres. We will also cover the speaking test, which one of our professional support leaders, John Holmes, will talk you through. And I'll just let him introduce himself to you as well. And he can tell you a bit about his experience so far. And he is based in Switzerland.
So, hello, I'm John Holmes, the professional support leader in Switzerland. Again, I'm speaking from my office in Switzerland on a beautiful sunny day. I hope everyone else is also having a beautiful sunny day today. Switzerland, generally for the last, in the east of Switzerland, for the last 5 weeks has been examining. So we've got really good working experience of best test practice that basically I want to take you through today to give speaking examiners, invigilators and centre exam managers any ideas that they can adopt with the use of the guidelines as well. And this will be my main part of this webinar today.
Great. Thank you, John. Okay, so we will get started. So we will turn our videos off for now while we go through the webinar, but we will show our faces again when we go through the questions. But I will talk you through some housekeeping first of all. So thank you. Oh, sorry. I seem to have turned the video off and the sound. Okay. Hello, everybody. Sorry about that. I will repeat what I've just done. Just one moment. Okay. So a bit of housekeeping for you. My colleagues, Helen and Laura, will be moderating the chat and will answer your questions if they can. If they cannot answer a particular question, we will get back to you with a communication after this webinar. This webinar will be recorded. And during the session, you can download your certificate of attendance. Well, sorry, during at the end. And if you don't manage to do this, we will send it to you and you can edit the PDF and write your name. We will also send you a feedback form. This presentation will be approximately 40 minutes and we would like to have 20 minutes at the end for questions. So it should be an hour in total. I would like to say, if you could wait maybe before you start asking questions, because we hope that we will cover as much as possible. You know, we have created this webinar in conjunction with exam centre staff on the ground who have had experience of delivering exams during this pandemic. Okay, so, but anything we can't answer, we will get back to you. Thank you. And also just to let you know that obviously during the pandemic, we're delivering this webinar in a slightly different way. And like most of you, we are working from home, but we aim to give you the best experience we can. As long as we know how to use the MOOCs and the video. We're relying on home Wi-Fi. I don't want to say anything now, but my Wi-Fi is normally excellent, so I shouldn't have any issues. But please be patient with us if we do have any issues. Okay, and before we get into the actual webinar, here are a few suggestions to help you to get the most out of today's session. Try not to have anything else running on your computer, especially Skype. Switch off any other programs if you can. We recommend headphones if possible to get better audio quality and to hear better. And don't worry if the picture is a bit blurry at first. This is because it's live and this should hopefully improve. As I already said, you can use the chat box, which is on the right of the screen. And you can also find the handout in this area where we will be directing you some handouts later on. And also there will be a couple of quick polls for you to do as well, which you will be able to find in the screen. I've already said this, but I will repeat, we'll be issuing you a certificate at the end of the webinar. And you can, if you don't have time to download it, then it will be sent to you. The certificate, as well as the slides and a link to the recording, will be sent to you. Okay, so let's get started. First of all, I would like to thank you for the role you play in being the face of Cambridge Assessment English on the exam day, for representing us whilst candidates arrive at your venue and take their exam. I know because I've done some Invigilator training face-to-face in certain countries, mostly Spain, that you do a great job of looking after the candidates whilst at the same time ensuring our regulations are followed and that the candidates have an equal and fair chance of performing to the best of their ability, as well as preventing and detecting malpractice. So again, thank you for all you do. So we'll start the first poll, and it's just a question really to know how you're feeling about invigilating exams again with the new COVID-19 guidelines. So my colleague will now activate the poll, and it will be nice to see, you know, how you're feeling at this time. Okay, so looking quite good, actually. Well, half of you are feeling fine, so that's great. Some of you are worried. Yeah, okay, so looking quite positive then. Some, yeah, no difference. Yeah, some of you are nervous, but this is understandable. And of course, you know, some of you are worried. Have a very experienced centre in Portugal who said actually he felt like it was when he first started doing exams 20 years ago, you know, like before he'd even done the Cambridge exam, he felt the same as he did then as he did now. But he said after you've done the couple of sessions, you know, you adapt, as we've all had to adapt in the situation, and then it becomes normal. Okay, great, thank you very much for that. Okay, I would just like to show you or remind you of the training website we have for Invigilators, also useful for centre exam staff, supervisors. The link is on the slide to the website, and you just need to sign up yourself and you'll be sent a password. It is available in 7 languages, which are English, French, Turkish, Spanish, Italian, Brazilian Portuguese and Polish. We are aware that some of you experienced an error with not having the current date on your certificate, and more recently, some of you have not been able to download the certificate. We really apologise for this. We know that it could be due to local browser issues, but also partly due to an update required for the website. If you have completed the online training and are unable to get a valid certificate, please contact your exam centre and we can assist them. However, please note this does not include the new COVID-19 regulations, as they can change. Although we will be updating the presentation, which we provide for your exam centre shortly. Also, just to let you know, at some point this year, we will be moving this content of this website to a new platform where the certificate issue will be resolved, and we will update your exam centres about this. Okay, so COVID-19 core principles. Always follow the instructions of national and local governments and healthcare authorities and the advice of the World Health Organization. Again, talking to an exam centre, they said, you know, you need to comply with the local laws and then the COVID-19 measures, Cambridge guidelines, and above all, common sense. Okay, so what I'd like to know from you now, another quick poll is, what do you think is most important to customers at the moment when interacting in a face-to-face stroke physical environment? And my colleague will now activate that poll. Okay, so looking like, yeah, cleanliness, helpfulness of staff, joint leaders at the moment. Okay, so we've got 33% helpfulness of staff, 34% cleanliness, 19% knowledge of staff, and 12% quality. Okay, right, thank you for doing that. Okay, so this, I'd like to share some research with you from a webinar I attended recently. Although this was research in the UK, I think it's useful to know what matters to customers most when in a face-to-face interaction. And for those of you not aware, F2F means face-to-face. So as you can see, cleanliness is like the top, the most important here, followed by quality. But what is relevant here for us, as in for Cambridge exams, is for the candidates, is cleanliness and helpfulness and knowledge of staff. So it is important that, as you would anyway, to be as helpful as possible to ensure the candidates know what to do and how to do it, and that you are trained by the usual means and informed by your exam centre of their and our new regulations related to COVID-19. And here from the same research, the top three are hygiene, cleanliness, PPE, which in English is protective personal equipment. This was 34%. So I think that as long as this is covered, prepared for and implemented, then the candidates should feel safe and reassured. 30% is what will be important is social distancing. Again, very important. And this will depend on the social distance guidelines in your country, as it is different in every country. For some countries, it is 2 meters. And therefore, the distance between candidates needs to be a minimum of 2 meters. This is the case in the UK at the moment, but I believe in 2 weeks' time, it's going to change to 1 meter. And therefore, our usual 1.25 metres distance between candidates would apply for written exams. Friendly staff was the third highest. Again, we say that Invigilators should be firm but friendly when instructing candidates of the regulations and carrying them out. But this is even more important now to ensure candidates feel at ease and comfortable and reassured. Right, so preparing for the exam day. What everybody needs to do, that's from your exam centre, yourselves, is communicate to the candidates what you are doing, you know, why you are doing it, and then what are the Cambridge guidelines, and then you just get on with your normal exam day. As I say, we have some of you, some countries have already started now, and some, you know, some are still some behind, like the Americas. There are not many exams happening in the Americas. As the research states, knowledge and friendliness of staff is very important. So you and your exam centre need to ensure that you feel comfortable and you know what you need to do to ensure you comply with the new regulations. I'm just going to show you the centre support site. This is not available for public use, but this is available for your exam centres. And I'd just like for you to see what we have done for the COVID-19 regulations. So there is advice for them and there are resources. Your centre exams managers have been attending weekly and regular webinars with Cambridge English staff regarding the new measures, flexible delivery options and exam day setups. We have an example there of a centre exams manager in Switzerland who are delivering exams now, and Portugal, and they've also presented their experience to other centres. The information provided here is a range of suggestions for ways to run our exams in line with social distancing measures. This is guidance, and you can adapt it to suit any additional measures mandated by the authorities in your country or region. We are easing some of our normal regulations to help you with meeting local government advice when running exams during the COVID-19 pandemic. We at Cambridge English cannot guarantee the health and safety of any candidates, centre staff or any other individuals, and we do not replace any government or public health authority advice. This is just an example of where your exam centres can see an example from a Swiss exam centre of an exam day setup. This is very helpful for centres who have not yet started delivering exams, but of course every centre will have their own process of doing things, and it also be dependent on the country and region and local government guidelines. This slide has also been shown to your exam centres, and it's good that you know as exam day staff and what the candidates should expect on the exam day. Both exam staff and candidates should feel confident and reassured that the measures are both in line with official regulations and designed to guarantee a safe exam experience for all. Your centre should ensure that you are well briefed to ensure you are clearly informed about their COVID-19 safety measures and feel prepared to deal with students and run the exam. Please check with the exam centre you work with for the exact measures they have taken to provide a safe and clean environment for taking an exam. Please also check with them regarding if they supply masks and any other equipment you may need, or if you have to provide your own. I have been advised by some centres that the staff are bringing their own. We, again, to repeat, at Cambridge English cannot comment on this, and it will depend on the country you're in and on the individual centre you work for. Okay, hygiene measures. Probably the most important topic. I've also been advised by exam centre that everything takes longer now, so a bit slower than normal. So, for example, you might have to disinfect a table between breaks, the waiting room. You may have to wait, a minute or so for it to dry. So just expect that things will take longer, but your centre exams manager should factor this into the whole of the exam day schedule. As already mentioned, this is one of the main priorities. Some of our exam centres who have delivered exams recently have provided hand gel, sanitizer for candidates to use, as well as exam day staff. You would be expected to clean the desks before and after the exam has taken place. And please note that these are guidelines and each centre will have their own way of doing things. But this is what candidates would expect as a minimum. Whilst the candidates are taking the exam, there will be exam day staff cleaning the bathroom between breaks, for example. This is of an exam centre doing just that. It's important to clean and disinfect all test venues before any Cambridge exams, including bathroom areas, the exam room and waiting areas. Okay, so now we move to the exam day. We have provided some posters for your centres for candidates on arrival to help them follow your COVID-19 regulations. Every exam centre should provide additional signs or information boards for candidates on arrival. As you can see, these are templates. You can either use them in the original format, or the centres can copy the text for their own use or translate them. There is no obligation to use these posters, and if you have any alternative arrangements in your own country, then please follow those. As always, if you do provide these ones and they have English writing on them, then they need to be displayed outside the exam room. Where possible, provide clear guidance, such as arrows on the floor showing social distancing. For example, in the waiting room, you place chairs 2 meters apart or put marks on the floor to show where people can stand while still being 2 meters apart. The actual distance may vary from country to country, so check your national or local guidelines on this. And this is an example of that one of the posters translated into Portuguese. Okay, identity checks. So invigilators still need to carry out identity checks as stated in the exam day booklet. We are aware that some IDs might have expired and cannot be renewed due to the current restrictions, as some governments are stating that expired IDs are valid for a further period. Please follow their advice, which we will accept. You could use disposable gloves to handle any IDs, and you may wish to wear masks while doing these checks. A centre in Portugal has done the following, of like held up the ID to the staff 2 meters away, so the candidate is holding the ID, okay? So you don't need to touch it. Or candidates could leave the ID on the desk, face up with the photo, so when staff patrol the room, they can see the ID without touching it. There are many ways that you can do this without having to have any physical contact. You may need to ask candidates to briefly remove their mask in the most sanitary way possible so you can see their face if you're unable to verify their identity with a mask on. Do not touch candidates' masks. And where possible, please refer to the World Health Organization guidelines on the use of face masks. We have told our centres to ask you to familiarise yourselves with these. If your regional or national authorities have published specific guidance about ID, please follow that. So that's the ID. So taking the test day photos. Test day photos for C1 Advanced are still mandatory. For B2 First and C2 Proficiency, test day photos are no longer required for Cambridge Assessment English. However, some recognising organisations might want to see the photo of the candidate. Your exam centre should capture this information from the candidate in advance. So they need to ask the candidate in advance if they need their exam for a specific purpose. And if they do, they will need to have their photo taken. I would like to reiterate the importance of this, because if the candidate does not have a photo taken and they need it for immigration, for example, it could affect their future, okay? Because a recognising organisation, if they can't view a photo of the candidate because it was not taken on the exam day, then they may not accept their result, okay? For all other exams, test day photos are not mandatory. Candidates cannot have photos taken with their masks on. The software that you use, Identica, will likely report an error. And even if the photo is taken with a mask on, the receiving organisations will not accept it. So if you are taking a photo, please ask the candidates to remove the mask in the most sanitary way possible. And you may need to sit further away than usual, but as digital photos can be enlarged, this should be okay. Candidates' belongings. Okay. What is different here? Well, more or less the same. The designated area for candidate belongings. Please think carefully, or your exam centre will, about how to prepare the area. Ideally, candidates should not bring anything unnecessary to the exam. Their belongings should not be touched to avoid cross-contamination. If there is no way to manage the designated area sufficiently, we can allow at this time for candidates to keep their belongings under the desk, either in their own bags, or you can give them a bag to put them in, which has their candidate number on it. These bags can go under the desk. However, they must not contain their electronic items. Please make sure that if their belongings are under the desk, that they do not pose a safety risk where candidates and staff could trip over them and injure themselves. Electronic items such as mobile phones, ideally should not bring them to the exam, but of course we know, you know, we are in 2020 and not many people are going anywhere without their mobile phone. But if they do, then they should be collected without cross-contamination. For example, you might instruct the candidate to leave them on a disinfected surface, then the candidate can return to collect it without anyone having touched it. This should be outside the exam room. If that is absolutely not possible and you have no other alternative, you can arrange this inside the test room. But please make sure candidates have switched off their phones before placing them on the table. We do not want phones to ring during the test, which can cause disruption, and we do not want anyone to use them to cheat in any way. Okay, so Your exam centres will give you copies of exam day booklets. However, we have provided them for you, the one for computer-based exam, the paper-based exams and young learners. So my colleague will activate them in the chat area so you can download a copy if you need to. So the exam day booklets remain valid in conjunction with COVID-19 additional guidelines. However, we have provided flexible arrangements due to COVID-19, and now centres are having to do more sessions with less candidates in each session, unless they have a very large venue. So you can, centres can now run the exam multiple times in one day, but you may need to make sure that you keep the candidates separate from candidates who have already done the exam. They can also run the exam on multiple days, well, for paper-based exams. You can also run the exam at any time during the day. So you're not restricted to the time specified in the exam day booklet, which is now on the screen, with the exception of C1 Advanced. With the exception of C1 Advanced, you may run the components in any order. For example, for B1 Preliminary, you may run the listening component before reading or writing. If you run the listening component first, you must not accept late arrivals, meaning you cannot allow them to take any following components. So that your exam centre will tell you all of this, but this is for you, you know, to know what to expect on the exam day, what you're expected to do, what you can and can't do, and the flexible arrangements available to our exam centres at this time. Handling exam material. So your exam centre may provide you with gloves, or you may need to take your own, but you can use gloves when handling IDs and exam materials. Something else that is different at this time is that you can prepare the materials on the desks while candidates are waiting, instead of waiting until candidates are seated before you give them the question papers and answer sheets. This is to help you minimise the time that you are close to the candidates. So as you can see on the screen, you can prepare them before, so they're all ready when the candidates walk in. On the exam day. So this is a photo from Portugal. Depending on your centre, and this is not compulsory, you might need additional time at the start of each exam for candidate health screening. In some regions, centres are carrying out contact-free temperature checks on candidates when they arrive at the venue. It may be required in some countries. If you just communicate verbally what you're doing and ask the candidate permission if you can do this, then great. If they don't want to do it, then it shouldn't be any problem at all, unless it is required by your country. You also need to think about developing a plan in case someone displays symptoms of COVID-19 during the exam day. For example, if they're displaying symptoms, you might want to cancel their test and ask them to leave the exam room. Outside the room, you can ask them to leave the venue or make arrangements for a parent to collect them in the case of a younger candidate. If doing this, as I know you're aware, it's important to handle it sensitively as it may be upsetting for the candidate. This image is from a report on an exam centre in Spain using a cider house as a venue, as they had a conference room where the centre could accommodate large number of candidates whilst maintaining social distancing. I'm showing you this because you can see candidates waiting to go in to the venue with their masks on. Until further notice, candidate centre staff and examiners can wear a face mask covering their mouth and nose during the test if they choose to do so or are advised to do so by national or local healthcare authorities. The use of face masks is allowed for both written and speaking tests. Exam centres can choose to provide invigilators and examiners with masks, or they can bring their own. If candidates choose to wear a mask, they are required to remove it briefly during ID checks and for test day photos. John will talk more about speaking examiners, but they can wear a mask, and neither the candidate nor the examiner should insist that the other remove or put a mask on for the test. If it isn't compulsory, then of course you have to. But, and if you want to remove it during the test, you should ask your partner, this would be the candidate, ask their partner and the staff if it's okay. You know, it's very important that everyone, the test conditions are the same from everyone and everyone has equality. Hygiene measures we've briefly mentioned, but I believe most centres will be providing hand sanitizers at all exam venues. These are now authorised items in the exam room, even though they're liquid. Clean all equipment, tables and computers between exam sessions. Headphones must be disinfected after each use. and you need to ensure that any material covering the earpieces can either be washed or disposed of. Candidates cannot bring their own headphones from home to use in the listening component. We've been asked this quite a lot, as they may not be compatible. Also, we need to ensure the security of the test is not compromised by unauthorized items being used. You know, we cannot guarantee the security of headphones from home, so they are not allowed. Make sure there is soap and suitable hand washing facilities in the bathrooms, which we have already mentioned, but it's good to repeat these things, as I think we get, as we probably all know in our own situations about how cleanliness, especially if you're dealing with the public, you're dealing in a face-to-face environment, it's important to have all these measures in place. Okay, so entering and exiting the exam room. This image is from a centre in the Netherlands where you can see that there is a separate door to enter the exam room and one to exit the room. So there is a one-way system. Candidates will need breaks, so please ask them to continue following the social distancing measures during the break times. There may not be sufficient space for invigilators to walk around the room as they normally would. Please do what you can, but we do accept that you may not be able to move around the room and check the performance in the usual way. However, please note that we will continue to scrutinise statistical evidence after tests to find any instances of suspected malpractice. And we appreciate your support, as always, in preventing and detecting malpractice and making sure no live exam materials are removed from the exam room. This image is also from a centre in the Netherlands. They arrange desks so that candidates can sit far enough apart during the exam. This is a paper-based exam. For example, if a distance of 2 metres is recommended in your country, then place the candidates 2 metres apart. If it's 1 metre, then it would be our usual 1.25 metres apart between candidates. So as maybe I've already mentioned, this means you cannot fit as many candidates in the room as usual. Therefore, your exam centre should consider using larger rooms or running tests back to back or on multiple days. They have all these options available to them, or we're being very flexible for everybody, apart from C1 Advance, because it is a high stakes exam and it is recognised for immigration, and therefore this is not possible. So, as I said, you know, they're maybe having more candidates in one day. So instead of having just one session one day, you might have to have two sessions in one day with less candidates to comply with social distance. Okay, this one is a computer-based exam. There are candidates there on their laptops. Again, you need to arrange desks so that candidates can sit far enough apart. Yeah, and repeat really the same as paper-based for social distancing, running tests back-to-back or on multiple days, except for C1 Advanced. Okay, so now we're going to finishing the exam. And let's see here. Okay. Yeah, if candidates have used extra paper for writing, ask them to show you it at a safe distance. If there is no exam content on it, they can take it with them. If they have written exam content that could be useful to other candidates, please ask them to place it somewhere for you to collect it. We suggest you probably use gloves for this and then dispose of it. What is different here than before is that when you would usually collect the materials before the candidates are allowed to leave their desk, for the current situation, you can ask candidates to leave before you collect the materials, but ensure they do not take anything with them. Please also inform candidates that if they leave anything behind after the exam, such as forgetting a pencil case, these items may be thrown away or destroyed for hygiene reasons. Candidates must make sure they take all their belongings with them when they leave the venue. So I suppose it's like when you fly, you know, make sure you take everything with you and don't leave anything behind. I just want to double check that I haven't missed anything out there. No, that's right. Okay, I'm now going to hand you over to John Holmes to talk you through the speaking tests and what new measures have been put in place. Thank you.
So thank you to Yasmin for going through all the previous parts of the exams, etc. And this now comes to the speaking tests. Basically, the speaking tests candidates normally arrive at the centres, put into waiting rooms, etc., as we can see with this picture. Yasmin's also mentioned this already, looking at distancing, depending upon the recommended distance between students according to either national, local centres, etc. Here we can see two students sat down in chairs, etc. I think what's also interesting here, it's a very old picture, is that if we think about it and use the word that Yasmin's used, cross-contamination and having to clean, Swiss centres, what they seem to be doing within waiting rooms is not having seating areas and candidates can stand, etc. It saves a lot of time having to wipe chairs down, etc., to disinfect. So this seems to be really a really, really good way. The second thing that's a slight change is that marshals will not be giving the sheets any longer to the candidates to take to the exam to take to the examiner's room their mark sheets. These will either be in the room or the marshals will be taking these with the two candidates to the speaking room, and giving the marshal will be giving these to the speaking examiners. So this is one slight change. It also means that there's a slight change to the rubric where examiners won't be asking, can I have your mark sheets, please, because they already have them. And that's about the only change in the whole of the rubric and connected in a way with the first part from the waiting room to the examination room. Basically, coming in, what happens in the examination rooms for examiners, etc.? Well, I think one point's been mentioned that teams are working much closer together, the marshals with the mark sheets, etc., passing on to examiners, making sure the right candidates are in the right rooms. And it's interesting because you said this was something that was as one of the questions in the poll, which received a really high percentage. The second one is basically handling of materials. As we can see here, this is for young learner starters. So basically the candidate had come in, we can see that there's the 2 meter distance. We can see here that there's a slight change in the way that the examiner's sitting opposite. This was actually a day when I was doing young learner starters to keep the distance. We can see that the materials have been placed underneath a desk mat, and the desk mat can be wiped down afterwards. What we can also see is we can see that the object cards here have been laminated again so that they can be wiped down afterwards. I found it really useful to have a pointer to be able to point to certain elements on the visual materials for the candidate, etc. And this worked really, really well. We also examined with masks, and there was no problem hearing each other, asking questions, etc., as would be expected. Some examiners are also using visors, and you can see these on some of the pictures later on. But this is one idea, putting the materials underneath this clear desk mat, which we can see in front of the candidate's chair. Again, going on for movers, very similar again. We can see there's a desk mat that can be wiped down. The material goes underneath. There's a pointer on the desk. One thing I found was having a laminated piece of paper for the final part of the paper, which is the odd picture that the candidate has to identify to cover the other three up was very useful. Again, if there's touching, etc., things have been wiped down afterwards, door handles, maybe chairs, desks, mats, etc. This, as Yasmin also said, can take a little bit longer between tests. So this is something that your SEM will either factor in or something that you'll have to be aware of. Again, here, we can see that we're into this is for certificates. Again, we can see we've got the 2 meter distance between We can see that the candidates' desks are, how can we say, positioned in a triangular pattern, again, so that we can try and enable them to collaborate to a greater extent in the third part of the test. The examiner we can see, or the interlocutor we can see, here's wearing a visor. We can see that the assessor's got a mask on. This is part two. Part two we've found from working, due to the follow-on question for examiners, it's very useful if the candidates have the same picture so that the listener can listen to their partner. And then when it's reversed, the interlocutor would stand up, turn the booklets over, and then move on in the next part of the test. And it works very, very well. It's one idea, again, it's with these desk mats, Again, wipe down between tests, etc., chairs, door handles, etc., etc. This is slightly different. It's virtually working the same way. We can see, again, we've got the 2 meter distance, or what's been recommended by your local authority. Materials, again, we can see it's part two for certificate, I believe. And these have been put into plastic folders. Again, it's so handling of materials, etc., and that they can be disinfected afterwards, etc. This is another approach that was taken by another centre in Switzerland. You can see here that they've got the two desks, left and right of the middle desk for the candidates. And you can see that they're putting the materials here on a desk in the middle. The candidates are not touching, they're not handling this material, but they can see it quite happily. And it's caused absolutely no problems at all here. I think one of the advantages from all the previous slides that we've seen is that there's been no photocopying. All materials are either held at the centre or speaking examiners have, etc. And this is there. So there's no extra work, there's no extra expense included with photocopies, etc. This is another recommendation. This is another centre in Switzerland. It used plexiglass. So here the students or the candidates are having to come in with gloves. We can see that there's materials in their, how can we say, their plexi booth. The examiner would have to direct the candidate to which material they have to look at. I believe this is a Beck exam. And they don't wear masks because of the plexi screens here. Again, it's good, it works, it's functional. It requires expense for the plexi screens, etc. And a little bit more direction during the test to make sure they uncover the right materials. Again, they were using gloves, but materials and plexiglass screens were being wiped down in between tests. This is a picture from the Netherlands. This is the approach they had to for handling the materials. As we can see here, we've got the interlocutor with big mask and gloves. The main difference here is it's becoming more technologically advanced in a way. They were presenting the materials via a projector. This has been okayed by Cambridge. Again, it's good. It could work. I think the negative factor could be it increases maybe the stress upon the examiners to be able to use the devices, whatever in the room, etc. Myself, with my own preference, I like the desk mats that we saw at the beginning. They were really good. They've been really practical and they've really worked very, very well. With the devices, etc., I think they're good. During an exam, I just have the worry that we could have a break with the connection, etc. And I would be tempted to go the other way. And this comes to our final section, your questions, if there are any questions.
Okay, thank you very much, John. Well, let's look at the questions. Yes, we will be sending a recording afterwards. It says, why are they not, okay, Elena, why are they mandatory in Cambridge Assessment English? Oh, sorry, not Cambridge, Advanced, sorry, and not in Proficiency. This is because C1 Advanced is recognised by Canada, Australia, for example, for immigration, and Proficiency isn't. And that is why C1 Advanced is mandatory. Okay, if I'm going back through the questions, you know, if we don't have time or we can't answer them, we will get back to you afterwards. There's a lot of information or comments about the self-declaration form. Yes, you're right. These are not compulsory. It's not legal. This is to help you. You know, we get asked many, many questions from exam centres. What about this? You know, especially in the beginning, quite understandably concerned and worried. And therefore, we provided this. So if the centre wants to use it, great. But, you know, it's not, it's to help you to say if you've got symptoms or you think, you know, because we can't be responsible and nor can the exam centre be responsible for anyone that may have symptoms or get the virus. What about running computer-based exams multiple times in the day, also running the exam over 2 days? Okay, so computer-based exams have sittings, AM and PM. Okay, so that's how that still stands. What we have done is given more flexibility. So if an exam centre wants to do more computer-based exams and not on the day schedule, they can apply for that. Okay, and they have, I believe, a 10-day window to do this. But please speak to your exam centre because they should know all of these details. And also the send to exams manager also have an account manager in their regional office of Cambridge English that is also helping them to deliver these flexible options. Okay. read out instructions without a mask, with mask. Yeah, absolutely. Why change the components order? My doubt is if the sessions could be taken in differently in the morning and in the afternoon. I'm not sure I understand that question. So I'm just trying to go through the questions, but then they keep disappearing. Okay, question. What about the survey that candidates have to fill out? Yes, that's a good question, Nuria. That survey, there seemed to have been, was still switched on and candidates were getting the survey and they hadn't taken the exam. So we've now turned that off for the moment. So they're not filling that out at the moment because of all the flexible dates. Wouldn't face screens be preferable to masks in speaking exams? Well, I think John's answered that one by showing the different options.
I think it's very good. Masks or visors? I think for speaking examiners, I think visors are really good. I think one, because you can bring a smile when candidates come into the room, etc. It definitely relaxes people. Myself, I've worked with both, and I would say a visor is probably more preferable. A mask gets very warm. I do wear glasses, and my glasses tend to fog up as well. So I would generally work with a visor. Another question's come up about YLE and if you have certain materials, etc.
Yes.
Basically, if they're underneath a mat, you just lift the mat and move the materials to the relevant parts. This was when I did movers. This was absolutely no problem at all, and the same doing normal exams for certificate or advanced, to take booklets back, to turn pages, etc. does not take any longer than what's normally accepted.
Okay, and there's another one, thank you. Says, you could reveal the lines from the bottom upwards. How do you intend to cover the odd one out pictures?
It worked really well. You start at the top and you do the set example, and then you can slide the piece of paper down to the second set, slide it down to the third set, and if I remember, for the last set I covered the top ones up, and this was no problem at all, absolutely no problem, and with a pointer. You can direct the candidate to which pictures you want them to look at. It was no problem at all.
Great, thank you. There's a question from Mark from Vietnam. We're already back to normal. Even in schools, there's no social distancing anymore. Are we required to follow these measures? No, absolutely. What I said in the beginning is that your local guidelines, your national, your regional, replace our guidelines, okay, for social distancing. So if you have no social distance in your country, that's great. And you don't have to follow our guidelines apart from the mandatory 1.25 meters between candidates, which is normal. Okay, so you still need to be doing that. But no, if you're in Vietnam, everything is fine for social distancing, then you don't need to follow it. Okay, somebody thinks we're running late. Could you make the certificate available at the end of the presentations before the Q&A session? That is one for my colleague who is the events expert to answer. Someone's a comment from Michelangelo saying, so we have two candidate booklets. I think you mean the exam day booklets. There are three. There is one for paper-based exams, one for computer-based exams, and one for young learners. Somebody, my colleagues mentioned about breaks. If candidates will need breaks, ask them to continue following the social distancing measures during the break times. If we have to stand up, change pages, etc., the timing of the speaking as a whole will have to be more flexible, right? How much flexibility is allowed?
I think it goes to common sense. From my own personal experience, I would say even by standing up and changing materials, etc., and putting them underneath the desk mats, there hasn't been a huge increase in the amount of time on the normal time of the test. Candidates are still having the set times that they have to respond to. So if it's 60 seconds, etc., it doesn't take many more seconds. It really doesn't.
Okay, great, thank you. Okay, I seem to have lost some questions, but anyway. So screen, we've shown that. Is there any flexibility in test time? You've answered that. Increasing evidence regarding gloves shows virus can still be spread. Best to use sanitizer after any candidate contact. Yes, and I think the basic advice is wash your hands regularly, and sanitizer. Shall speaking examiners just adapt the rubrics as they see fit, or will we be sent any instructions?
Sorry, can you say that again, Yasmin?
Yes. Shall speaking examiners just adapt the rubrics as they see fit, or will we be sent any instructions?
I mean, effectively within the guidelines that the SEMS have received on the COVID site, to not ask the candidates for their mark sheets is mentioned there. I think if you were, I mean, using body language to point to materials, etc., is not changing the rubric. To ask them if they can see materials, I think is not a huge change. Is not a huge change. So I would say that no guidelines will be sent regarding this because each centre could use a different approach for this non-handling of materials, etc. Not every centre is using the same way, so I would say no. Changes will not be sent out. Another question's also appeared about speaking materials. Both the assessor and the interlocutor have their own packs of materials, so you have enough materials in the room if you have to show part two the same picture for both candidates.
Great, thank you. Can Invigilators use a screen? Oh, I've just lost that one now again. I'm not sure. Asking if Invigilators can use a screen instead of masks. Yeah, absolutely. As long as that's okay with your exam centre. I mean, you're still protecting yourself. John's already given the benefits of using screens for speaking tests, but Invigilators should also be able to do that. Brendan, what about patrolling the room during written tests? Yeah, I did say that we understand that it might not be as possible as normal, to move about so much. So please do what you can. Please invigilate as you can. Obviously, we do rely on you to, prevent and detect malpractice and ensure the candidates are okay. So do what you can, really. Yeah, if you can, great. If you can't, then just, you know, please be vigilant. Can students hand sanitizer be allowed in the exam room? That's a good question. Well, we do allow, we're saying it's now a authorized item in the exam room, so which centres are providing for candidates. So I believe if candidates want to bring their own, but I mean, you probably need to inspect it just to make sure. But yes, it's an authorised item at the moment. Can declaration forms be sent to candidates before the exams via email or put on website to be downloaded prior to the exams, to be filled in and brought in or sent by email? I don't see why not. Again, you know, I don't know if you're an invigilator or work for an exam centre or work in the exam centre, but I'm sure each exam centre would have their own process. But yes, on the day, it's good to know on the day though, isn't it? Because you might feel fine, you know, a week or 2 days before, but actually on the day you might think, oh, actually, you know, I don't feel, or the exam, or one of you might not feel very well, you know, and therefore say, I don't feel well. Have speaking exams been run in separate rooms within the centre using Zoom or another platform?
This is something that Cambridge have put into operation and given permission for. It's basically if rooms are too small for distancing measures to happen, what they can do is they can use Zoom or an equivalent platform and have the assessor in another room, but still assessing the exam live. It can be a possibility. Again, for me, a question that I would ask is, can I maintain that I'm going to have internet connection during that complete test? And there's going to be no technological breakdown. If I was a SEM and I were running a speaking session, I think I would try to make sure that my speaking examiners are in rooms large enough so that I can keep it with the normal procedure of having the interlocutor and the assessor in the same room personally. But it is a possibility.
Thank you. How do you make sure that the air circulates properly? Do you have to open the window? Can you turn the air conditioning on? I don't see why not. There was one exam centre that had, you know, had the air circulating in the room. You know, it really depends what you think is hygienic or not. You do the most hygienic thing you possibly can. I think opening window would be a good idea. Yeah, and if you live in a hot country or if it's very hot at the moment, turn the air conditioning on. I don't see why not.
Another one that's come up has been about people cleaning down rooms. Yeah, in Switzerland, the speaking examiners were cleaning down the rooms in between. I've also seen that somebody's, I think it was Sophie or Sophia has mentioned that they increased the time between speaking tests by 2 minutes to allow the speaking examiners to be able to wipe down, etc., between the rooms and have everything set up for the next pair of candidates.
Thank you. Another one here, well, it's more of a comment about doing regional training, national level. Yes, your exam centres and also Cambridge regional offices have been doing Invigilator training, which can go into more specifics. This is more to give you some, you know, to visualize what other centers are doing around the world, you know, how it looks like for you and what you can be expected to do on the exam day. If we're allowed, okay, so we're coming to the end now, and we will go back to your questions, and we will give you the answers after it. And basically, I would just like to say, thank you Thank you very much, John. Thank you for your time and joining us today from Switzerland. I would like to thank you, the Invigilators, the supervisors, the speaking examiners and the centre exam staff for all the work you do to carry out the Cambridge English exam regulations. Thank you for taking the time to attend this webinar, which we hope you have found useful and reassuring. We will send you a follow-up with the slides and a feedback form and any answers we have been unable to respond to today. And we'll also send you a link to the certificate if you haven't been able to download it today. We wish you lots of luck and take care and stay safe and all the best from us at Cambridge English. Thank you very much and enjoy the rest of your day, evening, and we'll be in touch.